arose at the light of dawn. Their hearts were breaking with grief. They made their way to the garden to pray, remember, and weep. An angel stood by the open tomb. The stone was rolled away. The angel said, "Your Lord's not here. Come see the place. Come see the place where he lay. Alive, alive, King Jesus is alive. The grave could not defeat him. We will shout the news to the sky. Alive, alive, he lives and so shall I. Forevermore he reigns on high. King Jesus is." Filling the room, he said, "My peace I give to you. I'm risen from the tomb. I'm risen from the tomb. Alive, alive, King Jesus is alive. Not defeat him. We will shout the news to the sky. Alive, alive, he lives and so shall I. Forevermore he reigns on high. King Jesus is alive.
The bedrock, the foundation of the Christian faith, is the resurrection of Jesus Christ. If Christ did not rise from the dead, you and I are fools. We're believing in foolishness. We're believing in a dead man. He's still in the grave. There is no hope. We are still in our sins, and we're lost forever. But the good news, he has been raised, he is alive, and we serve a risen Savior. Turn in your Bibles to Luke 24. We'll be looking at that this morning, the resurrection story. Certainly there are many accounts of the resurrection. We could spend the next 5 Sundays going through these accounts, and it would be worth doing it, because so often we forget that we serve a risen Savior. Now, in this chapter, we're going to see the woman going to the tomb early in the morning to anoint the body of Jesus with spices. Well, of course, his body's not there. And then we find Jesus appears to 2 walking on the road to Emmaus, which is about 7 miles from Jerusalem. As they are walking, Jesus meets up with them and talks with them, but they did not recognize him. After that, Jesus will appear to the disciples and show himself that he's alive. Then following, he will give the great commission and ascend into heaven. So we're going to kind of flow through this chapter and pick up insights and things that will indeed admonish us to live that resurrected life that we are called to live. So follow along with me as I read the first 12 verses of Luke chapter 12. Then we'll take a look at them and move on. Now on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, by the way, I'm reading from the New King James, so it may be a wee bit different from the translation you're using, but essentially the same. Now on the first day of the week, very early in the morning, they and certain other women with them came to the tomb bringing spices which they had prepared. But they found the stone rolled away from the tomb. Then they went in and did not find the body of our Lord Jesus. And it happened as they were greatly perplexed about this, that behold, two men stood by them in shining garments. Then as they were afraid and bowed their faces to the earth, they said to them, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? He is not here, but is risen. Remember how he spoke to you when he was still in Galilee, saying, 'The Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified, and on the third day rise again.' And they remembered his words. Then they returned from the tomb and told all these things to the 11 and to all the rest. It was Mary Magdalene, Joanna, Mary the mother of James, and the other woman with them. And they told these things to the apostles, and their words seem to them like idle tales. And they did not believe them. But Peter arose and ran to the tomb, and stooping down, he saw the linen cloths lying by themselves, and he departed, marveling to himself at what had happened." Wow. What an exciting portion of Scripture. So here are these gals going to put spices on the body of Jesus. And they see these two angels. They're scared stiff. They bow their heads to the ground. And the angel asked them a question. "Why are you here? Why are you seeking the living among the dead? He's not here. Remember what he said to you." And he reminded them of the words of Jesus. "Remember what he said to you when he was among you in Galilee, that he'd be crucified at the hands of sinful men, and he would be raised again." And it says, and they remembered the words. And they remembered the words. You know, I think it's a great problem with Christians today, remembering. We know kids forget to do their chores, and they constantly have to be reminded by their parents to clean up their room, to pick up this, to pick up that. Wives remind their husbands to do things, and so on. We need to be reminded, don't we? And so it is in the Christian faith. We often forget what we were told. And it was so vital in this case, because these women who went and meant well to anoint the body of Jesus had to be reminded that Jesus was not there, that he kept his word, that he said this was going to happen. And it did. And they remembered. And it clicked. And they were so excited. So they ran back to the 11 at that time, and they told them what had happened, how the tomb was empty and how they met these angels and how this angel said, "He's really alive, he's risen." Well, when they heard these words, it seemed like idle tales to them, like nonsense. Isn't it interesting, in the unbelieving world, in this country, And indeed in the world, today is a day of Christians believing fairy tales, idle tales, superstition. To them, Jesus is still in the grave, if there ever was a Jesus, if he ever really existed. You see, to them, Jesus is dead. He's gone. And we're a bunch of fools believing in a dead man. And yet the world looks at it that way. And isn't it interesting that the disciples, when they heard the news, they considered it as idle tales, as nonsense. You might say at that point, the disciples were just as unbelieving as the world around them was. They disbelieved that Jesus was alive. The women were reminded. They believed. These who followed him for 3 years did not believe when the woman brought the word to them. But Peter now, on the other hand, Peter, it says, Peter got up, he ran to the tomb, stooping down, looking in, he saw the linen clothes lying by themselves, and he departed marveling as to what had happened. Now, to marvel means to be filled with wonder and astonishment, to be surprised, to be awed. And Peter was. What has happened here? Could it be? Did it happen? Has it occurred? It would seem Peter was moving in that direction quite clearly. Wow. As we move on to our next section of Scripture, 13 through 21. Now behold, two of them were traveling that same day to a village called Emmaus, which was 7 miles from Jerusalem. And they talked together of these things which had happened. So it was, while they conversed and reasoned, that Jesus drew near and went with them. But their eyes were restrained, so that they did not know him. Then he said to them, "What kind of conversation is this that you have with one another as you walk?" And it says, and they stood there and were sad. Then one of those who was named Cleophas answered and said, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem? And have you not known the things which have happened in these days?" And he said to them, "What things?" They said, "The things concerning Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word before God and all the people, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him up to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we were hoping that it was he that was going to redeem Israel. Indeed, and beside all of this, today is the third day since these things happened." Here they were dejected. They were sad. It was Easter Sunday morning, the third day. And they said, "We were hoping that he was the one." Perhaps, well, we saw all these miracles, all the things he did. But he's gone now. He's dead. He died like everyone else. And they stood there looking sad, hopeless. Now, isn't it amazing that they were talking to Jesus himself, the risen Christ, and didn't even realize it, because their eyes were being withheld from recognizing him? You know, I kind of think, do we easily lose hope and get down with all the promises that God has given to us in His Word, the Holy Bible, do we often lose hope? Do we feel saddened? Something else about this, verse 17 of our text. As they were walking, He joined them. He said, "What kind of conversation is this that you have with one another as you walk?" What kind of conversation is this that you have with one another? Have you ever thought about this? Jesus cares about the kind of conversations we have with one another. Now, that's a scary thought. Because sometimes we'd say, "Oh, no, I wouldn't want Jesus to hear the kind of conversations I have with some people sometimes." But He hears everything. What kind of conversations do we have as believers? Are they conversations of faith? Are they conversations of encouragement? Are they conversations of belief and trust and hope? Or, as this conversation was, a conversation of despondency, of sadness, of giving up. It's all over. There's no hope. Yet Jesus really cares about our conversations and the kind of conversations we have. How about your conversations? What kind are they? If Jesus came along and was walking with you today, and you didn't recognize He was Jesus, and He was listening to your conversation, would He be pleased? Would they be conversations of encouragement, of faith, of trust in Him, or of sadness and depression and lostness and despair? I think as Christians, we have much hope that when we speak and speak to one another, to have conversations that are full of faith in Christ, that are uplifting, that are encouraging, we serve a living Savior. It says they stood still looking sad because they thought it was all over. You see, they were living as if Christ was still in the grave. And might I submit to you, even though many Christians say, "I serve a risen Savior," that they live in practical, everyday terms as if Christ was still in the grave. And that's very convicting to me, and I'm sure maybe to you as well. Because if we serve a risen Savior, He's out of the tomb. He's alive. He's risen. He's with us. It should show. But so often we live as if He is still in the grave. I've heard the expression by some who make attempts at faith, and they say, "Well, I hope so. Well, I really hope so. Oh, I really hope it's true." But you can turn that phrase around and you can say, "I have hope because it is so. I have hope because it is so." He lives. We serve a risen Savior. Joyless, gloomy faces. Dear friends, that's not living like Jesus is really alive. No wonder the unbelieving world will look at us and see the joyless, gloomy faces that sometimes we wear and say, "I don't want to have anything to do with their Christ," if that's what it's all about. It's time for us to start believing what we say we believe. We serve a risen Savior. Wow, What a reprimand to me and others. Looking at our text, in verse 25, especially when he was walking with them, finally Jesus admonished them. Now, they still didn't know at this point it was Jesus. They must have thought, boy, this guy knows a lot about the scriptures, the Bible. This is amazing. And he said to them, "Oh, foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets had spoken." Ooh. The idea of being foolish, by dictionary definition, foolish means lacking good sense or judgment, unwise. And they were lacking good sense and judgment because they didn't believe their own Bible. They didn't believe their own scriptures. They were slow of heart to believe in all that the scriptures had said. And I kind of wonder, are we as Christians slow of heart to believe God's word? You see, they were taking their time about believing. They were slow moving. They were lethargic. They were sluggish. They were stagnant. They were, you might say, postponing and procrastinating. What is wrong with me as a believer that I'm so slow of heart at times to believe God's word, what it says? So he admonished them, "Oh, slow of heart to believe." And how about you and me this morning? Are we slow of heart to believe in the promises of the word of God to us? Are we lethargic? Are we stagnant? Do we take our time? Do we get around to it? Or do we believe God's word when we read it? Remember that old saying, "God said it, I believe it, that settles it." Right? Right there. Today? Well, I've got to think about this. Give me a little time. And there are times when we need that little more time. I don't want to say that. But so often, we just are very laissez-faire. We're so, "Well, yeah, I guess the Bible does say that. I'll give it some thought, you know, eventually, when I get around to it." Verses 26 and 27 of our text, he gives them the reason why they should believe. "Ought not the Christ," ought not the Messiah, "to have suffered these things and entered into his glory?" And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. Now that is an amazing scripture. He explained to them, starting with Moses, the prophets, and all the Psalms, the things concerning himself. How'd you like that for a Bible class 101, huh? Boy, to be a part of that, boy, taking notes, you couldn't write them fast enough. I'd want a recorder to get it down. But the Messiah himself, Jesus himself, teaching them, giving them the reason why the Messiah had to go through these things, why he had to suffer these things. But not only that, you notice at the end, he explained to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. You know what that's saying? That Jesus is the key to the unity of Scripture in all the Bible. If you trace Jesus through all the Bible, it unifies all to Scripture because it points to Jesus himself. Jesus is the key. But as we move on, we see in verses 28 and so on, they asked him to stay with him as they were walking. And they drew near to the village where they were going, and he indicated that he would have gone farther. But they constrained him, saying, Abide with us, for it is toward evening, and the day is spent. And he went in and spent time with them. How amazing. Then it goes on to say, Now it came to pass, as they sat at the table, as they reclined, that he took bread, blessed it, and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they knew him, and he vanished from their sight. Can you imagine that? So you're sitting at the table with this guy who knows an awful lot about the scriptures. And boy, I tell you, you get all excited about it. And so you tell him, hey, stay with us tonight. And he said he would. And he was breaking bread and giving it to them. And as that happened, they recognized him. Jesus! And he vanished from their sight. Wow. Can you imagine? Wouldn't you have liked to have had that experience? I mean, talk about cool, right? That is awesome. Can you imagine the stories you tell your kids and your grandkids and your friends? Wow. He vanished from their sight. What does that tell me sometimes? Sometimes in the circumstances of our life, Jesus is right there with us and we don't even recognize him. He's right there with us, walking with us, and we don't even recognize him. And he's right there. Sometimes we cry, we say, Jesus, where are you? He says, I'm right here. I promise never to leave you or forsake you. And he makes himself known to us, and we realize he was there all the time. He was there all the time. Can you imagine the excitement? But you know, these guys experienced during that walk heavenly heartburn. Yes, they did. Heavenly heartburn. Because after Jesus vanished from their sight, they started talking to one another. And they said to one another, Did not our hearts burn within us while he talked with us on the road, while he opened the scripture to us? Wow. Now that's the kind of heartburn I like. Heavenly heartburn. Christ, you see, wants to talk with us and walk with us on the road of life. He wants to walk and talk with you on the road of your life. And he wants to tell you many wonderful truths about himself from the scriptures. And when that happens, you will find, like Jeremiah did, your words were found and I ate them. And your words became for me the joy and the rejoicing of my heart. I tell you, when I first came to Christ many years ago, words just rung in my mind. The scripture that says, I write these things to you who believe on the name of the Son of God, that you may know that you have eternal life. 1 John 5:13. I was so excited about it. My heart burned within me. Because for the first time in my life, I could say, I know I'm going to heaven. I have that assurance, not because of who I am or what I've done, but because of who he is and what he's done. And I'm trusting in him. So I know what it is to have that assurance. And everyone here who's placed their trust in Christ knows they have eternal life and are sure of it because God's word says so and promises to that. And that's the kind of heavenly heartburn I want more often. Well, guess what? After this experience, they couldn't keep it to themselves, right? So in verse 33, it says, They rose up and went that very hour, and they returned to Jerusalem and found the 11 and those who were with them gathered together, saying, The Lord is risen, and the Lord has appeared to Simon, because they found out already the Lord appeared to Peter. And they told about these things that had happened to them on the road, how he was made known to them in the breaking of bread. Dear friends, when you meet Jesus, and every one of you here who has met Jesus, you've met the risen Christ, okay? You've met the risen Christ. Oh, you may not have come to the tomb. You may not have met him as Paul did on the road to Damascus. But you've met the same risen Christ. And when you've truly met the risen Christ, guess what? You can't keep it to yourself. You've got to tell others. That's what I did. I told my family. I told my friends. I told my neighbors. I told everyone to the point I think they wanted to avoid me for a while. They said, oh, here he comes. At least I felt that way. But the fact is, we're so excited that we've met the risen Savior. We're so excited that now we know him and we're children of God. We've been born from above and we have the free gift of eternal life and know we're going to heaven. Now, if that doesn't get anyone excited, nothing will. And so they were excited. They could not keep it to themselves and they went to tell others. Now, while this was happening, of course, Jesus appeared to them in their midst. Verse 36. Now, as they said these things, Jesus stood in the midst of them and said to them, peace to you. They were terrified and frightened and supposed they'd seen a spirit. And he said to them, why are you troubled? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Behold my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Handle me and see. For a spirit does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have. When he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. But they still did not believe for joy. And marveled, and he said to them, have you any food here? So they gave him a piece of broiled fish and some honeycomb, and he took it and ate it in their presence. You want proof? All right, I'll give you proof. Look at my hands. Look at my feet. When Thomas was there later, he said, Thomas, put your hand into my side. Be not doubtful, but believing. It's really me. Anything to eat here? Broiled fish, bring some broiled fish to me, please. So he ate the broiled fish in front of them. Can a spirit eat broiled fish? And then it began to sink in. It's really him. He's really alive. Jesus has risen from the dead. Wow. It's amazing. Now, when you think about this, it's amazing because these same disciples, listen to this. They saw him raise three dead people. They were there. Remember Lazarus, the widow of Nain, and the little girl that was raised? They saw him already raise the dead. They saw him walk on water. They saw him heal the leper and the paralyzed. He fed thousands of people with a few loaves of bread and fish two times. He calmed the wind and the waves. And still, they were slow to believe and doubtful. I mean, you look at that and say, well, I don't want to be too hard on them, but I kind of wonder if I'd be the same. Maybe I would. Even after seeing all of those things. Amazing. Look at verses 44 and 45. He gives them the great commission here. The risen Christ gives them the great commission. He said to them, these things are words which I spoke to you while I was still with you, that all things must be fulfilled that were written in the law of prophets and Moses and the Psalms concerning me. Remember we said, Jesus Christ is the key to all of the scripture. You keep him central, Old Testament, New Testament, it ties it all together. And he opened their understanding that they might comprehend the scriptures. That's another key. Unless the Lord opens our understanding, we will not really understand the scriptures. The psalm says, open my eyes that I may behold wondrous things out of your law. Dear friends, How amazing that is. Jesus opened their eyes to comprehend the Word of God. He explains to them that all of this was necessary. And he gives them, you know, the Great Commission. He said to them, thus it is written, and thus it is necessary for the Christ to suffer, to rise from the dead, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached to all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. And you are witnesses of these things. Okay? You've seen me. You've walked with me. You've spent 3 years with me. You've seen the miracles I've done. You've seen me crucified. At least some of them did. You've seen me now alive from the dead. You're witnesses of these things. And he says, I want you to go all to all the nations and share this. And share this. The good news. His Holy Spirit would empower them. Look at verse 49. Behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you. Tarry in the city of Jerusalem until you are endued with power from on high. You see that expression, with power from on high? That's the Holy Spirit. You go to Jerusalem and you wait till the Holy Spirit comes upon you. That's the beginning of the church, Acts chapter 2. And when you're empowered by the Holy Spirit, that's not only going to be with you, but that's going to live in you. You're going to be my witnesses. And you're going to receive power, power over the enemy, power for service, power to live the Christian life, power to lead others to Christ, power to overcome all temptations and every kind of thing that will confront you. Power to live the abundant Christian life that he had promised. And who said this to them? The risen Savior, Jesus Christ. And what did he do? In verses 50 through 53, he takes them out to Bethany. He blesses them. He ascends into heaven before them. Now, can you imagine that? I can't conceive of it. You're standing there with Jesus, and all of a sudden, he starts lifting off the ground. Off the ground. You're watching him just go into the clouds. I don't know about you. If I didn't have a heart condition, I would have had one after that. Or if I had one, I definitely would have had to pop some pills right away. The fact is, it happened right before them. He was swallowed up in the clouds. He told them that he'd be with them always, even till the end of the age. And they worshiped and they went back to Jerusalem full of joy. So what have we said? Well, the risen Christ ascended into heaven. But even though he ascended into heaven, the risen Christ is with us. The living, risen Christ lives in us. The risen Christ empowers us. And we are waiting again, and even today, for the risen Christ to come back. Are we ready to meet him? Are we serving him? You see, we serve a living Savior. We've said in this beautiful chapter a number of things that we need to be reminded, don't we, of the truth that he's alive, that he's with me, that his promises are true. We need to be reminded because we so often forget. And that you and I are not following idle tales. We're not following fairy tales, but the real thing. Jesus is the real deal. He really did rise from the dead. And as a Christian, I've got to stop it. I've got to stop walking around with a sad face, like I have no hope, like there's no joy in my life. I've got to stop living my life as a Christian like Jesus is still in the grave. I've got to realize he's come out of the grave. He's alive, and he's with me. And oh, yes. By the grace of God, I'm not going to be slow of heart to believe. I'm not going to be stagnant and lethargic. If God said it in his word, I'm not going to argue with him. I'm not going to take my time getting around to it. I'm going to say, Lord, I believe your word. You said it. You know, walking on the road of life, we're going to start believing, even though I may not recognize Jesus is with me. Jesus is walking with me on that road. And he's right there. Let's not forget it. And I've had that experience many times when I didn't think he was there. And then something happened and it brought my mind to Him. And I'd say, thank you, Lord. You were there all the time. Dear friends, if you've met Christ, you're going to tell others about Him. That's as simple as that. If you really know Him, you're excited. You're going to tell others about Him, whether they believe you or not. Just like they didn't believe the woman, right? They said, that's nonsense. You're going to tell others. And I'm going to show evidence. You say, well, how am I going to show evidence to an unbelieving world? You and I are going to show evidence of a risen Christ by the way we live. Because if they see a difference in us, if they see the joy, the happiness, the peace, guess what? They're going to listen when we talk about Jesus. I'm going to live in that power of His resurrection and the power that He gave me. Dear friends, I'm going to live my life in the light of His coming. He's coming again. And I want to ask you, do you serve a risen Savior? Do I serve a risen Savior? Then let's begin to show it. Because the world out there is not convinced at all. Let's show them that Christ really lives. Father, thank you so much for your word. Thank you for the truths that we've been reminded of today, that we do serve a risen Savior. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.